Hello everybody, happy 2015. It's Peter of England here, bringing you a video into the beginning of the new year, like I promised many people who contacted me by email. I know I haven't posted any videos on YouTube for around about 9 months, and there's been a reason for that. The reason for this video today is to bring hope for 2015, for all those people who were involved in a struggle against corruption and state control, domination of all aspects of society and our lives. What I thought I would do this time, at the beginning of the year, is to make an announcement of hope and an announcement of happiness. Instead of maybe dwelling on the rationale of defeating the banks, defeating credit actions in courts, parking tickets, and the usual run-of-the-mill things. So many people might say, well, is this running contrary to the free man movement's ideology? But I would maintain that it isn't, because what I'm trying to give is power back to the people and power back to you. And the way I'm looking to address this from another aspect or facet at the beginning of this year is to offer hope for people who have got illnesses or have got ill health or who are concerned for others within their family or within their close community who are suffering from probably, let's look at the major, should we say, three degenerative diseases that are currently affecting society and are supposedly beyond cure or are only treated with pills or potions or chemotherapy. So those main three areas would be probably the number one major killer would be coronary heart disease or arteriosclerosis. The second one might be cancer and all its related manifestations. And then another one, as a third, one of the greatest problems facing people today is when they enter into hospitals or medical care, they end up with either MRSA, or they end up with sepsis, which is another word for septicemia, which is an infection or a toxic poison in the blood, invariably picked up in hospitals, costing in the United States alone in, I think, 2010, around about $20 billion per annum to actually find cures for it, and these are infections picked up in hospitals. So, for those of you who live in the United Kingdom, we all know that the crisis within the National Health Service is at a probably all-time high. Morale is low. The doctors continue to treat people in the same old butcher, cut and run allopathic methodology. So what I'm actually showing you today is some aspects of what we might say are very, very controversial subjects. Now, I don't know how many of you out there will have heard of this, but there is an act. There is an act of Parliament created in 1939 which prohibits and actually makes a criminal offence for anyone to claim that cancer is curable. As surprising as it is, you can go onto the internet and search uk.gov.legislation and look up the Cancer Act 1939. And so for what I'm about to do now, this makes this a criminal offence for me to say to you that cancer is a curable disease. So this is what I'm actually coming out and saying, that cancer is in fact curable, but the cabal or the cabalistic collusion of the medical fraternity is openly hostile to any new cure manifesting in the healthcare or health practitioner domain, because of the sheer money-go-round and lucrative market that puts billions of pounds or dollars into the medical profession pockets year in, year out, with no noticeable, should we say, reduction in incidence. And if you actually see the chemotherapy and the radiography results for hospitals in the UK, they claim cure rates of around about 15 to 20%, I believe, but the actual cure rates are no higher than between 3 and 5. Because what they term a cure rate is anything that seems to have gone away, but invariably secondary cancer and carcinoma reappears some years later, resulting in the death of the individual. So cure rates for people, not incidents or attempts, are no higher than 3%. And lots of medical practitioners working in a, shall we say, a free man capacity, both fully qualified doctors and other healthcare professionals, do know and realise that there are other methods of curing, yes, curing, or greatly, greatly reducing the deleterious effects, giving a better quality of life for cancer patients. So, what I've got in front of me today is some product that you could look at and start considering as a way of, well, okay, you say these things are curable, but where's the proof? Because every man and his dog is out there saying, yes, there's a cure for this, there's a cure for that. One of the examples, Steve Jobs, pancreatic cancer. With all the money he had, he couldn't save his own life. Well, it's like everybody searching for a different religion. Everyone's standing on a street corner saying that they've got the way home to God, but very few people actually end up finding the way there. So, in Steve Jobs' case, pancreatic cancer, life expectancy, allopathically determined by the medical profession, is around about 3 years, probably 3 years maximum. Steve Jobs made it to about the eighth year before he succumbed. So, what we need to address is, for example, on the aspect of cancer, what actually is cancer? The medical profession maintain that it is an intracellular disease. However, the cutting-edge research by people like Dr. Tullio Simoncini and people like Tom Levy out of the United States, Tullio Simoncini in Italy, maintain that it is an extracellular manifestation that causes a particular abnormality within the system where a parasite actually causes or instigates the start of the carcinogenic, shall we say, ladder to death. What this carcinogen is in its infancy, and we all have it within us, so here's the problem, is something called Candida albicans. Many of you have heard of it. For those of you who don't know what it is, if you get up in the morning and you look at your tongue in the mirror, you might see that you have a white coating on your tongue, and that is the fungus or fungi Candida. And Candida is what's called a diploid. It's a diploid fungus which can grow as a fungus or it can grow as a filamentous cell. It's also what's called a facultative anaerobe, which means it can survive without oxygen, so it can go very deep into cellular structures. So, where does that leave us? We've got heart disease, we've got septicemia, we have got cancer. So, let's look at things as an opening salvo. A very good friend of mine has written a book, and it's called Primal Panacea, and it's by a chap called Tom Levy. He's a fully qualified doctor in the United States and also a jurist. And the basic title, and I'll leave this to you from the book, I'm not selling it, I'm just saying this is what the medical profession are saying here. Overwhelming documentation proves that in high enough doses, this substance, and he's referring to vitamin C, prevents and cures cancer, heart disease, infectious and degenerative diseases, and can neutralize and even reverse damage from virtually all toxins, venoms, and radiation. So these are quite dramatic statements that are made. The work concerning high-dosage vitamin C is anything but new, but the way of taking it is something that needs to be looked at. We can address this in other videos. Needless to say, you probably, if you're going to take high-dose vitamin C, to ensure that you don't suffer from what's called C flush, that means the vitamin C passes straight through the body and you end up on the toilet too often, you need to take it liposomally. That means that the vitamin C is encapsulated within a lipid so that it passes straight through the intestine wall into the cell and does its work where it needs to be done. Just to let you know that the research of arteriosclerosis or major parts of coronary heart disease is a deterioration in what's called the ground substance, and that is a collagen-like, thick, glue-type paste, which holds what's called the epithelia, the inside of the intim or the cell wall in its integrity. And what happens with reduced amounts of vitamin C in the system, and the human being cannot produce vitamin C, this ensures that these platelets within the cell, within the coronary artery walls, fall off. Just like the grout on the tiles in your kitchen or in the shower being insufficiently tacky to hold. And what happens is, as those epithelial cells drop away, the next part of the procedure is that there is a compensatory effect there, where the body tries to ameliorate the problem by putting another product in its place. And those products are cholesterol. It uses the cholesterol to build up the cell wall, and eventually what it does is it closes the artery wall into such a restrictive area that it causes the symptoms of coronary disease. So one of the things you've got to look at here is taking back your power, finding out through knowledge what is causing these problems. And don't allow the doctors to tell you you need to take cholesterol-lowering drugs, or you need to go on a particular diet, because the diet isn't going to fix it. You are, you could say in a very small sentence, that the major effect or the major cause of coronary artery disease is what's called focal scurvy, a lack of vitamin C manifesting to prove or to show the symptoms of scurvy on a focal level. So we've looked at what we might be looking to need here. Vitamin C, just so that you know, in its very raw form, comes in the form of a white sort of lemon powder, or tasting powder. This can be taken orally. It can be taken intravenously. But the most effective way probably is for you to take it orally in a liposomal capacity. So don't forget, this type of information is what you need to look at. There's a lot of work on the internet. The next thing then, if we look at the fact that we are now addressing the aspects of ill health caused by cancer, we need to then start to look at what cancer is. There's a product here that, if what we are saying is correct, is something that you should be looking at. I'll just come to it and show you now briefly. This is a product that is marketed as a chitin inhibitor, or a product that will degrade the protective wall of candida. So anyone suffering from candida, and if we're saying that candida is one of the major causes of cancer in the human being, then this is something that people might need to consider and look at. Because candida, as we mentioned before, is of the fungal kingdom. It can manifest in various ways within the human body, and it can move itself quite competently around the body. And typically what's happening is that wherever you find a tumour in the human body, you will also find the presence of candida albicans. Is this a coincidence? Well, what the medical profession would tend to say is that candida is an opportunistic parasite, and it migrates to the region where the tumour is. However, this is really saying that the cart is before the horse, and we will maintain that candida is actually the cause and not the effect. So wherever you find candida, you will find white, hard lumps, which are, in effect, the tumour. Now, candida looks as if over the last maybe decade or so has mutated, and it could have been genetically modified in the laboratory. However, that being the case, there's only one or two methods of combating it. One of the main ones is to try and degrade or deplete the protective wall around it. And the protective wall is what's called chitin. That is very, not very similar, it is exactly the same type of material that you would see on a cockroach's back or on the structure of an insect such as a fly or a bee, or more particularly for most people, as a comparison, a flea, for example. Yeah, let's look at a flea. You try and squeeze a flea within your fingers and you find you can hardly stop it or burst it because it's got this very, very flexible but almost crystalline coating, which is hard to get through. It's a little bit similar to the product of the fingernail. So this is something that's got to be defeated, and therefore what you have to make sure is you have a compensatory way of depleting the protective structure of this parasite that is within your system. And one of the main areas or main ways to do it is probably with a product called Lufeniron. This comes in various, I suppose, forms, but one of the most effective is a powder. Make sure you're not getting a pesticide quality, make sure you're getting a veterinary or human consumption product. And so dosing with that, and also then with what I would also recommend is something called colloidal silver, because silver has some amazing properties. If you look at any of the studies on the internet, studies have been done really as to what problems are facing the bee populations of the planet. And what's also been found within these studies is that there has been degradation of the chitin structure on the abdomen, on the thorax, and around the eye areas of these bees. And the electrocardiograph scans and MRI scans have shown that these are small deposits of silver that they've picked up. So whether that's a cause of chemtrails, whether it's a cause of silver being put in pesticides, I'm not sure, I don't know. But the one thing we do know, that colloidal silver seems to be quite effective in causing wear or holes in the chitin armour of insects, and therefore if that's the case it will affect the candida fungus. So that covers most of the things I want to say today. It's good news. I'm going to be posting many videos over the next, say, few months addressing these topics now in particular. So today is an overview. It's a good news thing for the new year. Peter of England is stating categorically, as members of the medical profession are stating, both in the United States and a few in the UK, that both cancer and coronary heart disease are preventable, and if you have them, are curable. The methodology behind doing it is simple enough for everyone to learn, and it's a case of you becoming a self-empowered individual who takes back not only his healthcare issues from the medical profession, but also comes away from this state control monopoly which tells you how to live and how to die and what things are good for you and what works and what doesn't. I'll end this broadcast now basically by restating the fact that this 1939 Cancer Act, which is still on the books and is still a tool which local authorities use to threaten and close down any, should we say, healthcare practitioner or alternative medicine practitioner who tries to claim their vitamin supplements or other things can cure or ameliorate cancer. They use that to threaten them with criminal prosecution. So I'm stepping out forward now and saying cancer is curable. We'll show you how to cure it. And by the end of this year, there will be many examples of people who have, should we say, made open testimony to the efficacy of these alternative cures. So, all the best for 2015. Make sure you subscribe. Peter of England signing off. Thank you.